this morning. Jeremiah 33, we'll be reading verses 14 to 18. This is God's holy, infallible word. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have promised to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days, and at that time, I will cause to grow up to David a branch of righteousness. He shall execute judgment and righteousness in the earth. And in those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will dwell safely. And this is the name by which she will be called, the Lord, our righteousness. For thus says the Lord, David shall never lack a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel, nor shall the priests, the Levites, lack a man to offer burnt offerings before me, to kindle grain offerings, and to sacrifice continually. This is the word of the Lord. God, may you speak to us through the reading and preaching of your word, and may the name of Christ ever be praised. Amen. Just prior to moving down to Mississippi, I was reading the novel The Red Badge of Courage by Stephen Crane. Has anyone read that book? Great book on the Civil War. It was published in 1895. Stephen Crane actually had a very sad life. But it was written during the time of Darwin's theory, during a time of Nietzsche's philosophy, and the economic and political turmoil of the late 19th century. And so it kind of reflects that within the novel. But it centers around a young man named Henry Fleming in a battle during the Civil War. Doesn't mention which battle, it's very vague. Actually, the Civil War to that book is really just a backdrop. And it's in the heat of the battle that Henry comes to the realization, this is what the novel's about, Henry's struggle. He comes to this realization that the universe, it's not looking out for him. Not his country, not his commanding officers, that there's no God above him, no one. That perhaps he is insignificant in the grand scheme of the universe. And in fact, maybe there's no grand scheme. There's no purpose. Everything's random. No virtue, nothing but chaos in a struggle for survival. There's no justice. There's no righteousness. There's no kingdom worth dying for, worth sacrificing. Thus, he does the inevitable at such a conclusion. He flees and deserts in the battle. Now, if you've read the novel, or if you haven't, spoiler alert, right? Henry returns in the second half of the book, and he fights valiantly. Yet in the end of the book, there's no character growth. There's no maturity. He doesn't celebrate in victory. Henry, in an unguided universe, has no great king, no God, no virtue. And he sees both his cowardice and his courage as nothing more but both animalistic. Nothing more, nothing less. It's a very depressing novel, but that's the point. You see, Western society today is finding itself in a similar existential crisis. What is our meaning? What is our value in the universe? Are justice and righteousness immutable, objective principles? Or are they merely concepts invented by our leaders to advance themselves, to enrich themselves at our expense? But the promise, the prophecy here from the prophet Jeremiah, what he offers us today, as we also take the next few weeks to reflect on the meaning of Advent, that meaning of Christ's coming, is that Jesus shows righteous leadership. He shows sacrificial love. He shows that there is a just kingdom in store for his people. So today, as we look at this passage, we'll focus on three points. We'll look at Jesus as the greater king, the greater priest, and a greater city that is to come. First, the greater king. Throughout the book of Jeremiah, there are these pictures of the coming Messiah, the advent of this Messiah. Pictures such as a spring of living waters, a good shepherd, the good shepherd, and here, the righteous branch, which is also throughout Scripture. It's here and also in Jeremiah 23. And the promise of the righteous branch is often used in Scripture of specifically the Davidic offspring. This coming leader will be David's rightful heir, as he will be an offshoot from David's family line, a branch off of the family tree. And the Lord made an everlasting covenant with King David that a king from his line would reign on the house, or on the throne, rather, of the kingdom of God forever. Don't you remember this from your Bible reading or Sunday school? 2 Samuel 7, I will raise up your offspring after you. This is the prophecy given to David. Who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom, and he shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. 2 Samuel 7. See, the Lord promises to David a king from his line to rule a kingdom forever. Kelsey and I, we've been to Israel twice, 2011 and 2012, and the Jews today, many of them, they're still longing for this hope. Many of them have become pessimistic as they haven't seen it fulfilled, so they've given up their faith. But many of them believe it will come with a great king who's going to rule in the Middle East over the kingdom of Israel. The other part of this prophecy here in Jeremiah is not only will he be of the right family lineage, but he will be righteous. Look back over the kingdom of Israel from the Bible. Think back to those Sunday school classes where you would look at all of the kings of Israel, all of the wicked kings and the leaders of this nation that throughout its long history had been corrupt and wicked. Israel eventually would split into two kingdoms, and it has such a checkered past with their leaders, mostly unrighteous kings. So at the time Jeremiah was giving this prophecy, it was King Zedekiah who was ruling over the kingdom. He was the last king of Israel, of Judah. His name, Zedekiah, means righteousness. But his reign over Israel was entirely unrighteous. He was appointed at 21 years old. He reigned for 11 years. And he tried an allegiance with Egypt during the great rule of Babylon against the counsel of the prophet Jeremiah. And King Nebuchadnezzar, finally, he had enough, and he destroyed Jerusalem and the temple in 586 BC. Israel was exhausted from their poor leaders, from their scandals, from their wars, from the rampant evil in their culture and in their nation. Think of our culture's place in history. There's a retired historian, a scholar that I follow. He publishes these history pieces on forgotten history. And he's been publishing these shorts on the most corrupt American presidents. Right? And he, you know, going back, you know, to the 19th century, but of course I've been following a lot of the ones on the modern presidents, everything from Richard Nixon to LBJ to even President Joe Biden, right? And it is exhausting the level of deep corruption that our nation goes through with presidents from all parties. And in fact, it's demoralizing. It's having its effect on us as American people, isn't it? And on top of this, we're facing all of these endless scandals with church leaders, business leaders, the banking system, social media, mainstream media. And if that weren't enough, Western culture is in a state of freefall as it seeks to detach itself from any transcendent truth, losing meaning and worth, all while maintaining a veneer of ethics. You see, our society, much like Israel, is catechizing its people to distrust those in authority. Israel had its fair share of corruption and scandals and greed from every corner, from false prophets to immoral priests to foolish and powerful hungry kings. So by the time Jeremiah was prophesying about this righteous branch, think of the faith it would take for these people to overcome their own pessimism. Their cultural position was not all that different from our own. But the Lord says through Jeremiah, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. Justice and righteousness. Words that mean right judgment, honesty, proper law, equality, impartiality, and the correct measurement. Are these qualities that we can trust today in our culture? I looked at recent poll numbers from Pew Research from just a month ago, published just a month ago, that public trust in the government, which has been low for decades, is at a near record low. Currently, 1% of Americans say they can trust the government in Washington to do what is right just about always. 1%. 15% said we can trust them most of the time. 15%. We don't believe we have leaders who can execute justice and righteousness in the land. But Jeremiah says, one day you will. He's coming. But he won't come from this world. You know, as we enter this Advent season, our culture is very much becoming a people of pessimism, surrounded by unrighteousness and darkness, but we should be a people of hope and of light. What is Advent about? Advent is a word with Latin roots that means coming. It carries the idea of waiting expectantly. We remember and we celebrate Jesus' first advent for his redeeming work while we long for his second advent. He's the king. He's the Lord. He's the president we've longed for, the one with no corruption, the one who will rule with justice and righteousness. Jesus fulfills these covenants, the covenant made with David, as he is David's offspring, the one who will rule on the throne forever. And not just the throne in one place in the Middle East, right? But the throne of the new Jerusalem. The throne of God, which extends over the entire universe. Jesus fulfills all promises and prophecies of this covenant of a king. But how can we dwell with one so perfect and so just and so righteous when we are so clearly not? Just look at what we've done to our world. The second point is the greater priest. This prophecy, it also promises this perpetual or ongoing service of the Levitical priesthood. Look at this. For thus says the Lord, David shall never lack a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel, nor shall the priests, the Levites, lack a man to offer burnt offerings before me, to kindle grain offerings, and to sacrifice continually. Not only was one promised to be a king who would rule forever, but that there would be a mediator between God and mankind forever. You all are used to hearing about this since we've been working through the book of Hebrews. Priests were part of the religious institution given in the Old Testament. The key priestly roles were to maintain holiness and to act as mediators. Right? We're sinful and unrighteous, and together we create a sinful, unrighteous, fallen world, a land. So there's this obvious need for a remedy. And this is where priests come in. They were necessary because without them, we're lost, unable to approach the King of Kings. So there was a need for these two separate offices. You see, whereas kings ruled for the good of their people, the priests served tirelessly for the good of their people. Nonetheless, if you remember from your Bible reading, or even Sunday school as well, there was that legendary blunder by King Saul. You remember that? Israel's first king. There were specific qualifications and strict rules for priests, almost none of which King Saul met. And King Saul had just defeated the Philistines, who were Israel's greatest oppressors at that time. They were the most serious threat to their nation. And Saul was to wait after defeating the Philistines. And he waited 7 days for the prophet to arrive following their victory. King Saul became impatient, and he was probably moved by the peer pressure of the crowd, and he made a sacrifice as if he were a priest. And that failure cost King Saul the kingdom. You see, these offices, the office of priest and the office of king, they were separate but perpetual in the Old Testament. Most of us are familiar with the promise given to the Davidic dynasty, but the Levitical priesthood shares a similar promise here in Jeremiah, here in this prophecy, that the priestly office would be maintained forever. However, we see that the same person would hold these offices. What once could not be done, God would accomplish through his great and glorious Son. We've seen this in our series on Hebrews, right? An anchor for a soul, that Christ is the perfect prophet, priest, and king. This priest-king would do what Saul could not. The priesthood of Christ supersedes that of Aaron, the Aaronic priesthood. The Levitical priesthood was only a shadow of what Christ would accomplish. He would hold this office, as Jeremiah promises, perpetually. The Hebrews chapter 6 says, "We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain," that place in the temple only the great high priest could go, "where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever." Hebrews 6. See, if you remember, the high priest would take the blood of your sacrifice and would go behind the temple curtain to the Holy of Holies and in the space where God's presence dwelt. And then they'd sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant by saying, "Jesus now enters there. We have a steadfast anchor because Christ has made a sacrifice and he mediates. And this sacrifice and mediation is sufficient forever." He wasn't carrying the blood of a bull or a goat, but he offered his own sinless blood, making full atonement, making full satisfaction for our sin. Jeremiah's prophecy here is of the first advent of Christ. It presents a problem and the answers to all our struggles. It's good news for the world that the true king is coming to rule in righteousness and to maintain justice. But it's bad news for us personally that the true king is coming to rule in righteousness, because we cannot maintain righteousness. We are sinners before God. Look at the struggles just a small little city like here in Vicksburg is having. But you see, the answer is that the coming king will be a priest who offers his sacrifice on our behalf to cover, to atone our sins before the king, and that he will maintain the holiness of his people, like the old Levitical priests tried to do, to guarantee that we will be a holy, righteous people. And if he can do that for us personally, then what does he do for the future city, the New Jerusalem, when he comes back and renews this world? This leads to our third and final point, a greater city. This priest-king would come not only to save his people from their sin, but to rule over them righteously. But there's this mention here that Jerusalem will then dwell securely. This future city will manifest and maintain justice and righteousness. And to the extent that this city will actually be known as the Lord, our righteousness. Our future home will finally be the sort of city in the land that the Lord had intended for it to be. Proverbs 29 says that when the righteous increase, the people rejoice, but when the wicked rule, the people groan. Proverbs 29 says, by justice, a king builds up the land, but he who exacts gifts tears it down. You see, there's this inevitable fruit of a just and right king ruling the world, ruling the land. Most of you know that my property, where I live over on Vicklin Street, that it borders, the back of the property borders Marcus Bottom. And, you know, living there, we've often heard gunshots behind our home. One time we heard so many, there was like five in a row, and it sounded like it was like right behind our house. So I called it into the police, and they acknowledged they'd gotten multiple calls, and they were trying to figure out from the calls, try to triangulate where the shots were coming from. And, you know, I'll read the paper, Vicksburg Post, and I'll learn about these victims and the suspects, and just think these young people are throwing their lives away, and they have so much to live for. The violence they experience is just, it's gut-wrenching. I'm sure you watch the news, you see what's happening in cities all over the country right now, and even in Europe. But you see, Advent, it's a testimony that Jesus has come, that he's our great high priest that has dealt with our sins. As a priest, he's dealt with that moral culpability that we have before the great just king. But the violence and the injustice of our sin still remain in this world. Right? Even if you haven't experienced violence, we've all experienced the effects of sin in our lives. Our own sin, the sin of others. And Advent carries the idea of waiting expectantly. While Jesus came as a priest during his first Advent, we eagerly await his return as a conquering king in his second Advent, that our city would be defined by righteousness and justice, that our dwelling will be called Yahweh, our righteousness, that there will be no more violence, there'll be no more tears, there'll be no more sin, that he will purge all violence and unrighteousness out of our land without purging us. Think of the hope that we are given in the gospel, that we aren't stuck without answers in some sort of existential crisis like Henry Fleming, where life is just chaos. It's a struggle for survival of the fittest, that there's no justice, there's no righteousness, there's no kingdom worth living for, there's no greater God worth serving. Henry couldn't dare risk sacrificing his life in that novel if these virtues and meaning didn't exist. But we don't live in that world. And as we lit the prophecy candle this morning, Jeremiah's prophecy is that despite the violence of the world, despite the corruption of our society, or even down to the secret sins of our hearts, that Jesus sacrificed his life for something, something virtuous, full of meaning, that his blood was shed to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, from our sin, to give us peace with God. And one day he will bring that peace with one another as his kingdom is made manifest over the entire world. That concepts like justice and righteousness exist, that they come from God, and that Christ came to lay down his life to satisfy justice so that it would not fall down upon us. Brothers and sisters, what a wonderful hope that we have in the gospel of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Christ, we praise you that you have dealt with our sin sufficiently on the cross, that you, through faith, that you give us through your Spirit, that through faith and repentance, we receive this wonderful work. Lord, we celebrate what you have done, coming to this world, taking on flesh. We are grateful. And yet, Lord, we long to see you come again, that we may dwell in your land in security, in safety, in a land that shall be called the Lord Yahweh, that Jesus is our righteousness. We offer you all of these prayers based on your merit and your mediation. Amen.